Hey, good news. We're here to talk to Robby Millsap today about optimizing your release processes through operational excellence. Welcome to the Azure Enablement Show, where we'll be discussing the challenges you and our other tech-savvy customers have encountered. Together, we're going to be talking with experts to find out how they think about these problems, recommended tools and best practices, and tips that they have learned from years of experience that you can use. So today, we're going to be talking to Robby Millsap about release practices, and I'm hoping you're going to join me. I think it would be a better discussion if I did this while I was in customer mode, so let me switch. Okay, that's better. Okay, so now I'm in customer mode. I think it's time to go talk to Robby. Hey, Robby.
Hey, David. Welcome to the lodge.
Thank you very much. So I was talking with Kunal about a problem we've been having at work. Basically, our release processes are terrible. And let me explain what I mean by terrible. They're terrible in that, like, we do a release like once a quarter sometimes, and it takes the entire weekend, and like the entire weekend. I don't get to see my family the entire time. And then after that, we spent the week after that just sort of, once we've gotten to stable, recovering and fixing the things. And sometimes it works and sometimes it doesn't. And it's just terrible. And on top of that, like, it's just terrible. So I'm wondering if you can help me out with some and talk me through some things.
Yeah, David, it sounds like you have quite a bit of friction in your release process.
Yes. What do you mean by friction?
Well, as you know, I'm part of the well-architected team here at Microsoft, and removing friction from the release engineering process is one of the principles of operational excellence.
Okay. Well, I guess I can understand that, and I understand that in terms of, I mean, the word friction makes sense to me because I'm always being told that we need to go faster, but I don't know how we would do that. Like, we put the release out there as fast as we can. Our tests all look great, and the things still break. There's like a whole bunch of stuff going on here. You know, it takes forever for the pipelines to run. Our tests, you know, even though we have these tests, they don't tell us that things are going to break a week later after we're done with the release. So it's just a lot of work.
Yeah, David, I have to say that sounds like a lot of what we call toil.
Yes, toil is in, what do you mean? So there's another word that I know, but I want to make sure I understand what you're meaning by it.
Yeah, toil consists of those mundane, repetitive, low-value manual tasks that you need to run a release when the release is exceptionally painful. Let me ask you, is there a reason that these releases are so spaced out? Is there a business requirement?
No, it's just the way we've always done it. We figured, like, you know, quarterly releases, everybody does it, right?
Part of an optimal release process is to seek out toil, the kind of things that you described, and aggressively eliminate them. And the key to that really is through automation.
So I dig automation. I think I know where you're going with this. Like, automate everything, I've heard a lot of times, and it sounds great, but for us, it's like, it feels like so pie in the sky. Like for example, it doesn't even like we can automate everything. For example, we need like these admin accounts with special elevated permissions to do deployment to our VMs. We don't want to put those in some sort of pipeline process or whatever. So like automating that sort of thing seems like impossible to us.
I think you'd be surprised if you really seek to eliminate toil and those manual tasks. You'll find there's a solution for a lot of these things that you're doing. For example, you presented the option, the example of these admin accounts. And maybe you don't want to put admin permissions outside of Azure, which I totally get. But you know that you can use just-in-time access accounts, which will give security privileges for a very limited window of time, and that's still backed by Azure role-based access control. So you're not putting your password into some external system. Again, seeking toil and aggressively eliminating it, you'll come up with some of these solutions like that.
I think we can could consider doing that, but I'm still not clear why automate everything is like the goal.
Well, where toil slows progress, it's disruptive, it's bad for team morale, which you've experienced. It's also very prone to human error, and these automated processes will shift efforts to delivering software, which is what developers want to do anyway, and what the business wants you to do, delivering features, not babysitting release processes at the end of every quarter.
That makes sense to me. So, okay, so I get that we need to think about toil, and I'll definitely deal with that. But can we go back to our deployments that are just like, you know, I like when you were talking about friction before. I just want to understand, like, what do you mean by that? Like, I'll give you an example. Like, our deployments always seem to have these errors. Sometimes, like, it's obvious we see in the logs, but sometimes we don't hear about it for a few hours or days, or maybe it's the week later. And we have to go look through 2 weeks worth of logs or code changes to figure out who forgot to check a certain thing. So, like, what do I do about these things?
Yeah, so I would say first, if there's no governance or compliance reason why the code has to be developed so infrequently, I would look at doing smaller, more frequent incremental changes and leveraging things like feature toggles to turn functionality on and off. It's a lot easier to turn something on and off versus a redeployment to roll back a feature. Also, it sounds like you might benefit from splitting up some of that work in parallel. For example, taking that code, building out different components, which you could put into a package manager like NuGet, and then you don't have to recompile the world every time. A smaller area of change means it's probably going to be easier to discover when something goes wrong.
Yeah, that makes sense to me. But when I think about things like you were talking about feature flags and stuff like that, like that's like a configuration thing. You know, we have issues with configuration, like, and especially because like we have multiple environments, like everybody does, like we have, you know, prod and dev and, you know, and staging and stuff like that. And managing the configuration between them is really tricky. And I'm finding like, I'm always going between them trying to compare config files.
Yeah. What you're describing, we call configuration drift, and it can be another source of friction. A great way to eliminate configuration drift is to deploy your infrastructure alongside your app code. I'm sure you've heard of infrastructure as code, and that's just that whole idea is provisioning resources by defining it in some declarative form, like an Azure Resource Manager template, or something that's actually checked in alongside your code.
So that makes sense. I mean, these environment changes do like cause us lots of grief here. Okay, so let's move on to kind of the next question, which is around the tests I was mentioning to you. So we've got this wide, we've got a whole bunch of unit tests. Like we're all in on the unit tests. That makes sense to us at all. And they turn green, and you know we don't deploy until they turn green. We try to do the right thing, but things still seem to break in production. And the business thinks at this point, like the business people are like coming to me like, why are you spending all your time on these unit tests if it's not finding these things? You know, what do you do?
That's a common question. I mean, unit tests are great at identifying coding mistakes, but they're only going to tell you so much. I would consider adding tests at every stage of your development process. For example, smoke tests to validate deployments. Integration tests to make sure your distributed components can communicate with each other, as well as stress tests to benchmark performance and quickly identify when a performance problem has been introduced.
So I get that, but sometimes code just seems, I don't know what the word would be, like brittle when it's deployed to production. Like it breaks easily. Like what do we do about that?
You know, one cause of that brittleness you described might be the way your code handles unexpected faults. I would look at injecting fault into your testing plan to ensure that your site keeps running even in a limited capacity when some of those dependencies go up and down.
Okay, all of this sounds super, and I'm excited to try these things, but I still imagine myself sitting there one weekend out of my month, you know, or more, while I try to just babysit the release process. And I can't leave the site down for maintenance. I can't like, you know, under construction. I can't put up a big like comeback later until morning because my boss would just kill me if we were down that long. So what do I do about that?
Yeah, I think I can help you with this one immediately. Ideally, deployments should be frequent and transparent to most of your users. Have you tried staging your workloads? I think that's something that you could do immediately. And let me give you an example. You've probably heard of blue-green deployments or canary releases, but the general principle is it's a lot faster to flip a switch and send traffic from one source to another source versus a deployment of new code that has to be applied on top of running applications.
I have heard of these things, and the reason why we haven't done something like blue-green deployment where you spin up two different versions of something and you're just like, okay, now we're blue, okay, and we upload the green side, and, you know, deploy to the green side, and then we switch to green, is I don't know how we're going to pay for it, right? Like it seems like I'm going to need like an entire replica of our production environment if I was going to do stuff like that. How do I handle that?
Yeah, that's a good concern. But you know, if you're using something like Azure Functions, which most people are these days, you know, you can use deployment slots to achieve the same thing. You could have a green and a blue deployment slot, and you could flip between those.
Okay, so that's cool. It's pretty clear that I've got a lot to think about here. If I wanted to go look into this more, like where would I go? What would I do? Where would you recommend I look at?
Yeah, everything you need to know about the Well-Architected Framework can be found on their website, which is down below. And we also have an assessment where you can actually evaluate your existing or any future developments against the Well-Architected Framework principles.
Cool. Well, that's super helpful. Robby, thank you so much for this. I think I'm going to switch back to host mode now. Okay, back to host mode. Well, I just want to thank Robby for joining me today, and I'd like to thank all of you for watching. I hope you'll join us again on another episode of the Azure Enablement Show.